Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 11247 in the name of Douglas Ross on independent investigation into the First Minister and Deputy First Minister. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Douglas Ross to speak to and move the motion around 11 minutes. Mr. Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. Truth is at the heart of the debate we're proposing today, and the efforts to get crucial answers for bereaved families who are looking to the COVID inquiries for informed responses, having considered all of the information. And all of us in this place have a collective responsibility to stand up for the integrity of our Parliament. If the value of what is said in this chamber is put into question, or worse, it is found to be untrue, then that diminishes our exchanges and makes our national debate poorer. What is said here does and must matter. While we will and should always debate their content, the validity of our speeches and statements should be beyond question. We owe it to our constituents, who expect their representatives to conduct themselves with honesty. If the public cannot trust parliamentarians, then that reflects badly not only on one individual party, but on us all. That's why the question before us today should be above the usual partisan considerations. This is not a battle of ideas. It's not a debate about how we best govern our country. It's a simple consideration of the facts and the evidence, of what was said, and whether there was a deliberate attempt to mislead. The Ministerial Code, signed off by Hamza Yousaf, is clear. It states, and I quote, "It is of paramount importance that ministers give accurate and truthful information to the Parliament." And on penalties, it says ministers who knowingly mislead the Parliament will be expected to offer their resignation. So what should happen next if the Ministerial Code has been breached is not in question. It's already there in print. And the motion that the Scottish Conservatives have put down today doesn't even make a final judgment on whether this chamber was misled by the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, though I will certainly put forward the case later in my speech. All it calls for is an independent investigation into whether there has been a rule breach and why. There shouldn't be a single member in this chamber today who cannot support that motion. And I can confirm we'll accept the Labour amendment today. But of course we will have to reject the amendment proposed by the SNP. I think people watching will find it incredible that the party of government will not even allow an independent assessment of what the First Minister and Deputy First Minister told this Parliament. If the government believes that there has been no breach of the code, then why would they not allow an investigation to go ahead to confirm their side of events? But I suspect it's because they already know what the findings would be, and that would not be favourable for Hamza Yousaf or for Shona Robison. But if the government is unwilling to allow that investigation, then let me today set out the facts and allow members and the public to draw their own conclusions. I will give way.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Douglas Ross giving way. And would he agree with me that one of the Nolan principles that requires accountability suggests that public office holders should, of course, submit themselves to the scrutiny necessary to ensure this?
Douglas Ross.
I absolutely agree with the member who chairs the Standards Committee in this Parliament. And let's not forget previous SNP government ministers, previous SNP First Ministers have referred themselves to the independent adviser. And I have to question why the current First Minister and Deputy First Minister are unwilling to do so. But it was in November of last year that the UK COVID inquiry wrote to the SNP government asking for, and this is a quote, "the extent to which there was informal or private communication about significant decision-making, including, for example, whether there were WhatsApp groups or other form of group chats which key decision-makers used." Then in February of this year, they asked for, and another quote, "any communications relating to key decisions, including internal and external emails, text messages or WhatsApp messages on Scottish Government and private or personal devices. Now, I will give way to any SNP member who can argue that that doesn't constitute a request for the messages. I will give way to any of them. None. No SNP member, presiding officer, is able to stand up in this Parliament and defend their government's argument that they had not been asked for the messages. And it's because that was not a request for a summary or a minute of the decisions made, but for the actual messages. And I think the silence from the SNP members suggests they know it. And let's be clear, that request wasn't made only once in February, but again in March, in July, in August, in September, and in October. So again, we're in a debate. I will give way to any SNP representative, having heard of all of these requests, who can claim that was not a requirement for the government to hand over messages. Not just SNP backbenchers, but I will give way to the Deputy First Minister if she would like to defend her case that that was not a request for messages. Nothing. Not a single member willing to do so. Because we know that on each of those occasions, bar the last one, the messages were withheld. Jamie Dawson KC, the counsel to the inquiry, said this 3 weeks ago. The Scottish Government has provided the inquiry with no WhatsApp or other informal messaging material, either in its own possession or the possession of individuals. So we have a situation where 9 months ago the Scottish Government was asked for WhatsApp messages to be provided to the inquiry, but they were only handed over last week. Yet on the 31st of October, the Deputy First Minister said this. In June this year, the inquiry came back to ask for groups of WhatsApp messages, the titles of those groups, and who the members of those groups were. And then in September, the inquiry asked for the individual messages, refusing to mention the fact that the inquiry had made similar requests in February, March, July and August. However, Shona Robison went further. In response to my questions in this chamber on the 31st of October, she said, "It is not correct to say that it has been over a year since that request was made. It has been just over a month." That is not the truth. The evidence supplied by the Deputy First Minister herself in the Scottish Government initiated question on the 8th of November contradicts this. And let us not forget that this evidence was only supplied by the SNP Government because they were forced to do so by the UK COVID inquiry. The Scottish Government were all too happy to be spinning a different tale on timings until the inquiry called them out. The First Minister was even more definitive in his framing of the request. On the 2nd of November, he said this. It is crucial to say that when the UK Government inquiry asked us in June for details of the various WhatsApp groups concerning COVID-19, it did not request the messages themselves. The messages were asked for in September, just a matter of weeks ago. Again, that is not true. It is a false statement from the First Minister to this Parliament. Details of the WhatsApp groups were asked for a year ago, not 5 months ago, as Hamza Yousaf has claimed. And it was 9 months, not a matter of weeks, that the SNP Government left request after request for these messages outstanding. When I raised this with the First Minister last week, he said he had interpreted the requests too narrowly. Too narrowly. They didn't consider the requests at all. They ignored them time after time after time. 2 weeks ago, not a single WhatsApp message had been transferred from the Scottish Government to the COVID inquiry. The Scottish Parliament has been told contradictory stories about key messages the SNP Government should have provided to the UK COVID inquiry and when that crucial information was requested. Hamza Yousaf and Shona Robison should be ashamed of their blatant attempt to deceive grieving families who lost loved ones during the COVID pandemic. They chose spin and secrecy over transparency and truth. How can we draw any other conclusion that they have not been honest, they have misled Parliament, they have broken the ministerial code? I'll give way.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. And would he agree with me that it's actually that context? Because what's at stake here is the context of key decisions that were made in government at a time of crisis. And critically, failure to understand that context will mean we can't learn the lessons we so badly need to learn for future crises.
Douglas Ross,
I absolutely agree with Daniel Johnson, and I will repeatedly say this. It is not up to the Scottish Government, to SNP ministers, to say what is relevant or not for the COVID inquiry. We need to get full answers, full transparency, so they have to hand over absolutely everything. Now, let's be clear. The most senior SNP members were still dodging scrutiny by refusing to launch an independent investigation as per their amendment today. But on the 26th of October, the First Minister promised me in this chamber that the government would fully investigate why those messages had not been transferred and that the Solicitor General had been tasked to lead that investigation. Yet that's the last this Parliament has heard of it. So in the interests of transparency and openness, will the Deputy First Minister update us today on the status of that investigation and on the one launched by the Permanent Secretary? If not, then I expect many will assume it's because it would again reinforce that the First Minister and Deputy First Minister have not told the truth, that the requests for meetings dates from February rather than September, as they claim, and as a result, both Hamza Youssef and Shona Robertson have deliberately misled this Parliament.
Mr Ross, I think you're well aware of standing orders in relation to accusations that members have deliberately misled this Parliament. Just a warning that we should be steering clear of that, and that's not just in relation to yourself, but the Chamber as a whole through the context of this debate. Mr Ross.
I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I will be careful, but I believe it's deliberate because these statements were not a simple slip of the tongue. They were a product of a concerted effort to confuse and muddle the timeline to make it seem as though the SNP government were not dragging their heels in getting evidence to the inquiry. Presiding Officer, as I have shown, the facts are clear. There can be no doubt that the ministerial code was broken, that the information given by Hamza Youssef and Shona Robertson on the timing and the scope of requests from the UK COVID inquiry was false. Yet there is a due process that can be followed. And therefore, I urge Parliament to vote for our motion today to launch an independent investigation. If the government do not believe that there's been a breach of the code, why would they not want that to be investigated? Exactly. The UK COVID inquiry exists to give bereaved families the answers they deserve on the motivations for the decisions taken during the pandemic. They should be given all of the information they need to find those answers. They should not have to call out the two most senior SNP members to do so. And if members in this Parliament do not stand up for honesty in this chamber, then this government will always feel able to keep us and our constituents in the dark. It is past time that members of all parties stood up for the truth in the Parliament in which they serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Ross. I now call on Shona Robertson to speak to and move Amendment 11247.2. Deputy First Minister, around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I hope to set out today why I not only reject the motion but also reject its premise. And I want to start by repeating the acknowledgement of the First Minister last week that, in hindsight, we do recognise that the Scottish Government interpreted the earlier requests for messages from the UK inquiry in a way that was too narrow. And like the First Minister last week, I want to offer my unreserved apology to families who have been bereaved by COVID for any distress that our actions as a result of that interpretation has caused them. I'll take an intervention.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful indeed for the Deputy First Minister taking my intervention. I keep hearing the government use this excuse of interpreting the requirements of the UK COVID inquiry too narrowly. Too narrowly. I don't understand that. We were all, many of us served in this Parliament at the time of the COVID emergency. We all knew this inquiry was coming, and consistently the government insisted it would fall over itself to provide messages and evidence to the inquiry, yet this is the interpretation we have.
Deputy First Minister,
so
I can give you the time back.
Let me go into some of the detail on that in response to Alex Cole-Hamilton. In my statement of the 31st of October and in answers, I did acknowledge that there had been initial requests from the UK inquiry for messages. The Scottish Government's interpretation of the requests from the inquiry at the time was that they were related in the main to decision-making. As we have already set out, the Scottish Government did not and does not routinely take decisions via messaging services like WhatsApp. Subsequently, and in line with the inquiry's request, we have provided a far wider scope of almost 28,000 messages to the inquiry to go along with the thousands of documents that had already been shared. We are committed to full cooperation with both the Scottish and UK inquiries, and the reason for this is simple. As others have said, learning the lessons from the pandemic is vital to prepare for the future. The Labour amendment today makes... Yes, OK.
Daniel Johnson.
I struggle to understand why the government misinterpreted the request and interpreted it so narrowly, because surely the point of an inquiry is to understand why decisions were made. Therefore, the context of the decisions is critical, and therefore those messages were of course relevant to inquiry. So why did the government make that decision? Why did they interpret it too narrowly?
Deputy First Minister.
The focus was on decision-making and providing the record of decision-making. And the subsequent requests from the inquiry asked for that broader range of context that Daniel Johnson is referring to. And that is, of course, what I set out in my statement in terms of the various stages, including that request for WhatsApp groups, the request for those messages within those WhatsApp groups. And that's why, of course, that the timeline put in through the GIQ was important to set all of that out in detail. But, you know, I'm not going to stand here and not say that lessons need to be learned from all of the handling of whether it was the response to the initial inquiries or indeed any other issues, because the last thing I want or the Scottish Government wants is to upset any of the bereaved families. That is absolutely not the intention here, and I would regret any of that having been the case. I want to move on to the legal very briefly, because I need
Douglas
to move
Ross.
On.
I'm grateful for Shona Robson giving way. Can she confirm when she, as a current member of the government and a member of the previous government, was made aware of the request in February for the full messages? When was she personally made aware of that?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, when I was making the statement, the preparations for the statement, it was very clear the advice to me of what the Scottish Government's interpretation was of those earlier requests was for decision-making. And my statement was made on the basis of that. What the First Minister and I have said since then is an acknowledgement of looking back at those requests, we can see the inquiry has a point, and that is why, of course, the GIQ put that information of the whole timeline, all of the information that was asked for, into the public domain. I want to move on to the legal advice, because the Labour amendment today makes reference to the legal advice provided to the Scottish Government during the pandemic. The Scottish Ministerial Code explicitly states that Scottish ministers may acknowledge publicly that they have received legal advice on a particular topic, but must not divulge either who provided the advice or its contents, whether it's from law officers or anyone else. This is a long-standing convention of respecting the legal professional privilege of legal advice provided to the government, privilege that I understand that governments elsewhere in these islands also follow. The Code also sets out that where, in exceptional circumstances, ministers come to the view that the balance of public interest lies in disclosing either the source or the contents of legal advice on a particular matter, the law officers must then be consulted and their prior consent obtained before any disclosure takes place. Such consent will only be granted where there are compelling reasons for disclosure in the particular circumstances. It is the view of ministers that disclosure to the inquiries fits with a commitment towards transparency. As a result, Scottish Government officials have sought an agreement with the inquiries, giving them full access to unredacted material that is legally privileged. We will also be seeking to ensure that the inquiries are able to disclose that material if they consider it necessary to do so, subject to any overriding contrary public interest. Our overall commitment will be to full transparency. The First Minister has set out to the Chamber that such... briefly.
Megan Gallagher.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for giving way. How can this government be fully transparent if WhatsApp messages were manually deleted by key players during the COVID-19 inquiry?
Deputy First Minister, I can give you the time back.
I dealt with in my statement at length about the record management policy of this government, and that is that decision making, whether it's on WhatsApp or anything else, should be transcribed to the official record. That is set out very clearly in the record management policy and remains the same. What I'm talking about here is the legal advice, and I want to conclude the point, because it is the view of ministers, as I said earlier, that disclosure to the inquiries fits with a commitment towards transparency, and I hope that's something that will be welcomed. The First Minister has already set out to the Chamber that such a decision by the Scottish Government officials to seek redactions would only be in exceptional circumstances where they had a legal responsibility to do so. And I would stress that they would also be required to advise the inquiries of their reasons for doing so. I can confirm to the Chamber that we are close to an agreement with the Scottish Inquiry, and we are in ongoing discussions with the UK Inquiry. I don't have time, sorry, I need to make some progress. Further to my previous statement, and in line with a request from the UK Inquiry, I have provided Parliament, as I said earlier, with an extensive timeline of the request from the Inquiry through a GIQ answer last week. That answer provides a full timeline of the request to the Scottish Government and how we've complied with those requests. The Scottish Government has worked and will continue to work to provide the UK COVID Inquiry with the material it requests. In total, more than 19,000 documents have been provided to the UK Inquiry. I don't have time. In relation to messages collated by the Scottish Government, we sought and received from the UK Inquiry a Section 21 notice to ensure we could process personal information contained in the messages lawfully to the Inquiry. With that legal basis in place, we have transferred over 14,000 group messages and a further 14,000 messages between individuals. That takes the total number of messages that have been shared with the Inquiry to almost 28,000. Now, I should clarify that I have not seen the messages that have been transferred to the Inquiry, but I am advised that they include messages from current and former ministers and civil servants. There will, of course, be material and messages that will have been provided by individual witnesses who have received Rule 9 requests. However, to be clear, ministers do not have access to the responses of individuals. These are rightly matters between those individuals and the Inquiry. With your indulgence, Deputy Presiding Officer, I have just a few comments to make on record retention.
I can give you a bit more time, Deputy.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to highlight the information regarding the handling and retention of records, including but not limited to informal communications by the Scottish Government that I provided in my statement made to the Chamber on the 31st of October. The Scottish Government's duty to create and retain records has remained consistent throughout the period that the inquiries are looking at, and we've complied with that duty. The Scottish Government actively submits to record management review processes with the Keeper of the Records to ensure that our approach is compliant with the law. A detailed record and evidence of key decisions that were taken during the pandemic has been maintained by the Scottish Government. Our policies fully comply with our legislative obligations under the Public Records Scotland Act 2011 and other legal obligations, which is why we've had such a volume of material to share with the inquiry. The Scottish Government's record management policy makes plain that there must be the transcription and storing of salient information from informal communications, such as evidence of decision-making, to the centralised record system. The record management policy continues to apply to all records. The guidance has always been clear that regardless of the platform or new and emerging technologies, information that is relevant to the corporate record must be saved. These practices for good record management are the ones that we'll continue to promote at every level within government, and they're kept under review to ensure they remain fit for purpose. Since the introduction of these policies, the government has been asked to ensure that the retention of any and all material that may have relevance to the work of the inquiries. The Permanent Secretary and the First Minister have been clear with the Scottish Government these requests must be adhered to.
The Deputy First Minister is just concluding.
Okay, I'm sure the Minister for Parliamentary Business will be able to address that in the closing speech. Finally, I'd like to finish by underlining our commitment to do all we can to ensure that the important work of both the inquiries can proceed at pace. That is in all our interests, and we owe nothing less, not only to those who have lost their lives or lost their loved ones in the course of the pandemic, but also to all those affected, including many public sector workers that pulled together during this difficult time and whose work made it possible for our society to return to the normality enjoyed by all of us. I move the amendment in my name, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Just a reminder to anyone who hasn't yet pressed their button but who is intending to speak in the debate to do so as soon as possible. And I call Anna Sarwar to speak to and move Amendment 11247.1 around 7 minutes. Mr. Sarwar.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I think it is important that we start by acknowledging why this issue matters so much. It isn't just because it speaks to an SNP government which has lost control. It isn't just because the story is another example of the secrecy and cover-up which has tainted the SNP's approach to so many of the scandals rocking this government, from ferries to public safety or to the state of our NHS. It is both of those things, but most importantly, it's about this SNP government being held accountable for their decisions and conduct during the most tragic event in living memory. During the worst of the COVID-19 pandemic in Scotland, thousands of our fellow citizens died. Young people saw their education disrupted at levels we've never seen before, and with consequences we still don't fully understand. Untested and COVID-positive patients were sent into care homes with devastating consequences. People were shut away from seeing friends and family. People fell sick and were left to die alone. Their families mourning alone. That's why every ministerial decision and the conversation that informed them weighs so heavily, not just on the politicians who made them, but in the homes of every single family across Scotland. That's why this issue matters. Because across this country, people deserve the truth about how these life and death decisions were made. And this isn't just about learning the lessons for the future, it's also about delivering clarity and hopefully some closure for so many people living with heartache across our country. The least Scots could have expected was that their government would make getting the truth as easy as possible. But, Presiding Officer, that has clearly not been the case and not the strategy adopted by this SNP government. Despite claims from Humza Yousaf as far back as May that the Scottish Government should be, in his words, absolutely open and transparent, we have seen attempts to withhold vital evidence from the inquiry, all while changing the excuse every time the story fell apart. In June, I asked the First Minister directly, and I quote, "Will he confirm that all ministers and officials, past and present, have complied with the Do Not Destroy instruction, and will he give a guarantee that all requested emails, texts and WhatsApp messages will be handed over in full to the inquiry?" He gave a direct and simple answer. He said, and I quote, "Yes, they will. No equivocation, no caveats, no grey area." He went on to say, and I quote again, "To ensure that there is simply no doubt whatsoever, any material that is asked for, WhatsApp messages, emails, Signal messages, Telegram messages or whatever, will absolutely be handed over to the COVID inquiries and handed over to them in full." His words. His response was either hubris, naivety, incompetence or perhaps all three. Regardless, it's clear that it must be referred for an investigation into misleading this Parliament. And in June, the First Minister told the Parliament, "I will give way."
Douglas Lumden.
I thank Anna Sarwar for giving way. From what he's explained, you know, it's a very serious matter. Does he agree with me that it would be more relevant for the First Minister to be here today to listen to the arguments being made?
Anna Sarwar.
Well, I only hope, I mean, yes, in ideal circumstances, I think the First Minister should be here. I can only hope that he listens to this debate or at least reads the transcript of the debate. I know from the last 2 weeks he hadn't certainly read the transcript of the COVID inquiry, but perhaps he'll take the time to read the transcript of this debate. In June, the First Minister told the Parliament that the government had, again, and I quote, "a long-standing policy on retention, including email and social media messages." Then it transpired that Nicola Sturgeon and Dacian Leach had deleted the WhatsApp messages And the First Minister then changed the story and told the media that the government, and again I quote, had a social media messaging policy which actually required us to routinely delete WhatsApp messages. Required us to delete routinely WhatsApp messages. Then the Deputy First Minister told Parliament that 14,000 WhatsApp messages would be handed over to the inquiry, and then suddenly the First Minister, having told the inquiry he didn't have WhatsApp messages, miraculously found an old phone with his messages from the time and says he will hand them over to the inquiry. Now, what I don't understand is, I don't understand whether he misled the inquiry and is now clarifying, misled Parliament and is now clarifying, or maybe he just broke the own guidance he's saying the government had about actually requiring us to delete WhatsApp messages. I mean, was he breaking his own policy? Utter confusion, utter loss of control and utter confusion. I will give way. I hope you get some clarity from the Deputy First Minister.
I've been very clear in my statement and what I've said today, and that is that the requirement around messages, whether they're WhatsApp or anything else, is to transcribe any decision-making into the corporate record. Anna Sarwar surely understands that no organisation can keep every single message about every single thing. It would not comply with the law to do so. So the requirement is that messages that contain important salient information is transcribed to the corporate record, but they should not be retained forever, because that would be a breach of the legal obligations of the organisation.
And so I can give you the time.
I mean, that's an even more confusing answer, because what the Deputy First Minister is saying, that the First Minister has breached the guidance of the government, because he's saying he's kept all his messages and will hand them over, but somehow the guidance is that messages have to be deleted. It's complete and utter chaos. And to put it into context, the government supplied 14,000 messages. Matt Hancock alone, one person, as opposed to 70 officials and ministers, one person handed over 100,000 messages to the COVID inquiry compared to 14,000 messages. I'm aware of time, but if I'll get time back, I will.
I can give you the time back. Deputy First Minister.
Just to be clear again, and today I have updated Parliament that there are 28,000 messages that have been transferred to the inquiry, but in addition to that will be the individual responses to the inquiry, which I haven't seen, but no doubt will contain WhatsApp messages and other elements of material as well.
Let's listen to the person who is the chair.
I'm sure the Deputy First Minister's fog brain would have sounded like clarity to her, but it doesn't sound like clarity to anyone actually watching. What remains unclear is whether the First Minister told the inquiry he didn't have messages. Was it before or after having committed in June to supplying all the messages in full? Perhaps time will tell on that. But, Presiding Officer, that's not all. 3 weeks ago, counsel to the UK inquiry stated that they'd asked for the Scottish Government for copies of informal messages such as WhatsApps in February. And on the 31st of October, the Deputy First Minister told Parliament that the UK inquiry first asked for messages in September. The First Minister repeated that claim on the 2nd of November. He said, and I quote, "The messages were asked for in September, just a matter of weeks ago." Both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister directly contradicted the counsel to the inquiry statement on the 26th of October. And it was only after being forced by the UK inquiry that the Deputy First Minister sought to correct the record. And if that were the extent of the falsehoods, Presiding Officer, it would still be an open shut case in my view in terms of that investigation on misleading Parliament. But the reality is it goes further, because the true scale of the cover-up that many fear is taking place is still unclear, because this SNP government has repeatedly refused to answer even some of the most basic questions. Now, the inquiry has made clear that there's no issue with confidentiality with some of these basic questions and answers. So that's just another false excuse from this government. The First Minister has still failed to tell Parliament, of the 70 ministers and officials, how many have failed to comply with the Do Not Destroy notice and how many have deleted messages. Still no answer. Why did the Scottish Government hand over redacted legal advice to the inquiry when it provided legal advice in full to other judicial inquiries in the past? Still no answer. Now we've had a clarification that there will be the supply of unredacted legal advice, but the question still remains, Deputy Presiding Officer, why does it take the UK covert inquiry fighting with the government to get legal advice they're entitled to? Why does it take this government being shamed in this parliament for them to do what they've done for every single judicial inquiry in the past? But it's also been reported that SNP ministers and special advisers use SNP and private emails accounts to communicate. So I ask again, how many emails from SNP accounts have been handed to the inquiry? How many? And if none, why not? Now, in closing, Counsel to the UK Inquiry has said that if the information now provided by the government is insufficient, the inquiry will want to know why. But so too will this parliament. Presiding Officer, the First Minister has lost control of his government. And he, in my view, requires to be referred for an investigation into misleading this parliament and trying to cover it up. We were promised full transparency and cooperation with the inquiry, but they failed. And as much as they try and hide and hope it all just goes away, for the sake of the families, they must and will be held to account.
Thank you. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton, around 6 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I'm grateful to the Conservative Party for making time for this important debate this afternoon. Presiding Officer, transparency matters. In the boardrooms of the private sector and indeed in the corridors of the Scottish Government, transparency matters. And William Douglas reminds us that sunlight is the best disinfectant. He is not wrong. Without it, the rot sets in. And there is very little sunlight in the Scottish Government right now. Thousands of grieving families are looking to these inquiries for the answers, and UK government WhatsApps released already so far show minute by minute what was really going on behind the scenes in London and how those decisions were made. It shows that the discussions behind an order were often as important as the order itself. That the UK COVID inquiry had to instruct Scottish ministers to return to this parliament and set the record straight speaks to, at best, a casual attitude towards the work of the inquiry, and at worst, an attempt to undermine it. Whichever analysis is correct, the Scottish Government has been deliberately slow-walking its cooperation with Baroness Hallett and her commission. The inquiry's requests were in black and white. They could not have been clearer. The government said that they had interpreted it too narrowly. Narrowly. I said this in my intervention to the Deputy First Minister. That defence would suggest a minimal and grudging approach to cooperation instead of being as open as possible. It was only when the pressure from the inquiry became too great, when the pressure from the media became too great, that the Scottish Government were finally embarrassed into playing ball. I really hope that this does not delay the evidence and findings of the inquiry, or worse still, act as a barrier to the answers that those families are entitled to. I'm also grateful to Anas Sarwar for bringing forward Labour's amendment today. It gives us an opportunity to debate the functionality and the application of the ministerial code. Should it just be for Humza Yousaf and his ministers to reserve themselves to the independent adviser? Or should there be provisions more like the Ethical Standards Commission, where any third party who presents a threshold of sufficient evidence can trigger an investigation? Presiding Officer, we'll hear a lot from government benches today about the volume of messages that have now finally been passed on by the government to the inquiry. But drowning it in 28,000 messages, unredacted as they may be, will not make up for what isn't there. It has been reported that the messages handed over by the Scottish Government are mainly from group chats featuring three or more ministers and civil servants and do not include one-to-one exchanges between members of the government. Reports also suggest that the former First Minister and senior government officials were routinely excising their message feeds. And we can argue about what the SNP were asked for and when, but for me, this is the rub of the matter. Secrecy, selective memory, a failure to record or retain the records of the most important meetings are nothing new to the SNP, or in particular the former First Minister. And thinking back at that time, it was an unprecedented time. We all laid party politics aside. More trust existed then between opposing front benches than ever before or since. Nicola Sturgeon said her government would make mistakes, and we all accepted that in the knowledge and understanding that we were in uncharted waters. And I will give way to Daniel Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. Would he agree with me that some of the evidence that we've already heard from the UK COVID inquiry about UK government decisions that what's been revealing is that the culture and the way the organisation was making decisions, which were as important as actually the substance of the actual decisions themselves. Do we not have the same interest in having the same information about the Scottish Government?
Alice Cole-Hamilton, give you
the time back. Grateful for Daniel Johnson's intervention, absolutely. That cuts to the heart of this, that the background chatter behind the decisions that were taken are as important, and the culture that they reveal are as important as the decisions themselves. And we all agreed that, the government would make mistakes, but that if those decisions were backed by science, then they would stand up to the scrutiny of the inquiry we all knew was certain to follow the pandemic. Presiding officer, if Nicola Sturgeon has deleted key messages which informed her response, messages that might show how she weighed science against politics in the consideration of those decisions, then she too undermines the work of this inquiry. A particular tragedy of Scotland's pandemic story lies in the decision taken in April 2020 to move untested and COVID-positive patients from our hospitals to our nation's care homes. But we will forever be denied a comprehensive understanding of the discussion that led to that, because we will never have all the messages. There has long been belief that the former First Minister would deliberately breach the trust of collective four-nation decision-making to dash out announcements before anyone else, to look like she was leading the field. That she took decisions based solely on a desire to be different from Boris Johnson. She will never be able to fully dismiss those suggestions, because we will never have all of the messages. Lives and livelihoods hinged on these decisions, and yet people at the heart of this, Nicola Sturgeon, her advisers, were erasing the discussions that underpinned decisions like these. Those grieving families, those who've been failed, may be forever denied the full story behind the calls that she made. The gall of it, the barefaced mendacity of it, to state repeatedly in this chamber, from the floor on which we stand, that Nicola Sturgeon and her advisers would open themselves up to the full scrutiny of an inquiry that we all knew was sure to follow the pandemic. And then it seems to go home at night and systematically delete the very evidence those messages could offer. That reality, presiding officer, could yet prove to be one of the biggest scandals in the history of this parliament. Presiding officer, sunlight is the best disinfectant, but this is a governing party that is afraid of the light, afraid of the truth that they conceal, and afraid of the judgment that would surely follow, be rendered by the people of Scotland, should those ever truths come to light. I fully expect the SNP and Greens will protect their leaders today, but if this debate has achieved nothing else, it should at least exert pressure on the government to offer greater cooperation to the UK COVID inquiry, and by extension, offer answers and a degree of closure to the grieving families at the heart of this.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call first Megan Gallagher to be followed by John Mason in around 5 minutes. Ms. Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Why is this government not telling the truth? That is the big question that remains unanswered in the SNP's Secret Scotland. For weeks, Douglas Ross has forensically questioned the First Minister over what information key players in the COVID-19 pandemic handed over to the UK inquiry. But the answers given by Humza Yousaf and Shona Robison just don't add up. On the 31st of October, it was announced that the Scottish Government was initially approached for WhatsApp messages by the UK inquiry in September. On the 2nd of November, the Deputy First Minister then said that they were approached in February. You would have forgiven them if it was a few days out, but 8 months is not a simple mistake. Were they mendacious with the truth? Or why did they fail to correct the record if it was an honest mistake? Those questions are why the Scottish Conservatives have brought this motion to the Chamber today. Presiding Officer, something stinks about the SNP's attitude towards handing information over to the COVID inquiry. And it's the duty of every member of this Parliament to find out why. If the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister were confident in their positions, they would refer themselves to the independent adviser of the Scottish Ministerial Code. If they've got nothing to hide, they've got nothing to worry about. But instead, we have the whitewash amendment from the Scottish Government, one that lays bare their arrogance, that completely avoids themselves of any scrutiny or accountability. And that brings me on to the WhatsApp messages. We've been told about the 14,000 or 28,000 WhatsApp messages that they have handed over, but every time they are challenged on the deletion of WhatsApp messages, they crumble, because they know. They know that people who made key decisions during the pandemic have manually deleted WhatsApp messages. Jamie Dawson from the UK COVID Inquiry said this: the majority of messages have not been retained. Now, there will be some in the SNP benches that will say, so what? So what if these messages have been deleted? We have been told that the Scottish Government did not make key decisions on this platform. Well, I challenge every minister or former minister today to prove that no key decisions were taken, to prove that information deleted wasn't relevant to the COVID inquiry. But you can't prove a negative, can you? That's why people are up in arms about this, because the key players, Jason Leach and Nicola Sturgeon, were told not to delete messages during the pandemic as it could be relevant afterwards. But now even the UK inquiry believe that vital information could be lost. And I find that shameful, Presiding Officer. And I'm sure that the bereaved families who are wanting answers will also find this behaviour shameful. Presiding Officer, I referenced SNP's Secret Scotland earlier because transparency has never been their strong point. We've seen it time and time again. Ferguson Marine, the botched Police Scotland IT systems, the false claims around offshore wind, and who can forget the party's finances probe, which, by the way, is still ongoing. The government party is shrouded in secrecy, and Scotland is worse off for it. Members in this chamber from all parties have a choice today. They have the choice to stand up to this government and show that transparency matters, that truth in this parliament is more important than partisan political interests. And I'm sure that there are many colleagues. Yes, certainly.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful to Megan Gallagher to give way. And would you not agree with me that, of course, it is inherent upon the members of this place to be transparent, but it's also a requirement under the Nolan principles that you need to be open, you need to be transparent. It is a demand made on us for taking these roles.
Yeah. Megan Gallagher, I'll give you the time back.
Absolutely, and this is why this debate is so important today, because I'm sure that there are many colleagues from all parties who stood for election for the same reasons that I did, to represent their communities, but also to make sure that Scotland is a better place. They did not stand for election to defend the sleek-it behaviour and evasion, to be lobby fodder for a government that's determined to pull the wool over the eyes of the Chamber and the public. Presiding Officer, it is past time that this Parliament stood up for itself, that its members showed some backbone and forced this government to tell the truth. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call John Mason to be followed by Daniel Johnson, around 6 minutes. Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. The subject of cross-government transparency is an important one and impacts on all levels of government, whether at Westminster, here at Holyrood or at local government level. Now, the original title for today's debate was cross-government transparency, but none of these words actually appear in the motion, which I guess I find a bit surprising, but so be it. Now, if we start with the COVID pandemic, it's worth reflecting on how we as a Parliament dealt with it. We had frequent statements from both the First Minister and other ministers, with ample opportunities to ask questions about decisions, why they were being made and when they were coming into force. We also had a COVID committee of which I was a member and was chaired when I joined by Donald Cameron, and I have to say quite fairly chaired from my memory. Week by week we had the relevant minister and usually experts like Jason Leach and Linda Bald either answering questions in public or advising the committee. And I think we should remember too that we were in unknown territory, with limited information, but having to make urgent decisions. It's all very easy to go back with hindsight and consider how we might have made different decisions, but broadly speaking, there was a lot of agreement here at Holyrood. Yes, briefly.
Edward Wayne.
Thank the member for giving way. To be able to look back with hindsight means you have to look at all the records that are there. And what we're talking about, the fact is that we haven't got them. So how do you square that circle?
John Mason.
Well, I think the question is relevant records, and I don't want to go into all... No, that is what was asked for in February, as I understand it. It was the relevant records, not every cup of tea or coffee or whatever else. But to carry on, we might have made different decisions looking back on things, but broadly speaking, there was a lot of agreement here. Now, as I think members know, the Finance Committee recently carried out an inquiry into government decision-making. We spoke to past and present civil servants and ministers, and came up with a number of recommendations. But it seemed clear to me that whatever systems we have, there needs to be some private space to bounce ideas around, to brainstorm and to talk off the record. Yes, as a principle, openness and transparency are good things, but we all need space with family, with friends and with staff where we can let go, think out loud and bounce ideas around. And I think, no, not just now, I think that's what WhatsApp was thought of in that space. So now, how we were using WhatsApp at that time and how do we use it now? So I was looking back at the COVID committee WhatsApp group from June 2021 onwards. And I would like to quote you some of the messages. Some of the members I see are here today. And if anyone would like to read them all, they're very, very welcome to. But I find messages like the one from Murdo Fraser. Well done, Siobhan, expertly chaired. Brian Whittle, still in traffic on the M8. Murdo Fraser, I'm in a long queue trying to get into the car park. Jim Fairley, morning all, happy new year to you all. Brian Whittle, running 5 minutes late, and there were quite a few from him like that. So it kind of shows what WhatsApp was being used for and is being used for briefly.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to John Mason to give way on that point, but does that not just reinforce what we've already heard in this debate, that understanding the culture that surrounds decision helps you understand the context in which the conclusions were reached?
John Mason, I can give you the time back.
Well, my thinking is that WhatsApp ideally... Can I speak, please? My thinking would be that ideally WhatsApp should not be used for decision-making, key or relevant or anything else. I would not be surprised if there were no relevant messages on WhatsApp. Now, we will see that in due course. But I've given way already. Now, I'm fascinated that the Tories are making really what I think is a mountain out of a molehill in this debate today. We could have discussed Israel and Gaza, or inflation, or college disputes, or fire service pay, but no. The Conservatives want to know if Shona Robertson was stuck in the M90, or if Hamza Yousaf wanted chocolate on top of his cappuccino. Now, we have several public inquiries.
Excuse me, Mr. Mason, could you resume your seat? The amount of background noise has just escalated. Could I please encourage you to do the courtesy to the member who is speaking to listen to what his contribution is, and that same respect will then be afforded to subsequent speakers. John Mason.
Thank you. We have several public inquiries going on, and so what is the purpose of these public inquiries? And I would suggest that is different for different people. Families who have lost a loved one during COVID want to know what happened and why decisions were made. Now, I should perhaps declare an interest here in that my mother, aged 93, died in a care home in early 2021. We had very limited visiting during almost a year, and I personally felt and continue to feel that that was the right way of handling things. The care home became my mother's home, and the care staff there became close friends to her, and frankly, she got on better with some of them than she did with the wider family. However, even within my own extended family, there would be a variety of opinions as to whether more visiting should have been allowed, and I fear there is just no right answer to that. But absolutely, many families are looking forward to whatever conclusions the inquiry brings. However, it has to be said that parts of the media and some opposition members have different hopes for the inquiry. Some of them just want juicy gossip to boost their audience numbers, while others in here and outside just want to give the SNP and the Scottish Government a kicking. Now, on the subject of transparency, it's useful to compare Holyrood to Westminster and elsewhere. For starters, we all as MSPs are elected, which would seem obvious in a democracy, but of course the House of Lords is not elected, nor is it at all transparent how people even become members of it. And we now have the ridiculous situation where the Foreign Secretary is in the House of Lords rather than the House of Commons, and so cannot be routinely questioned by elected MPs. So in conclusion, yes, openness and transparency are good things, but there needs to be a balance struck. Publishing everything can have a chilling effect and limit fresh thinking. There needs to be a space for privacy and confidentiality. And if that is not to be WhatsApp, then it needs to be somewhere else. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. I now call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Stuart McMillan around 6 minutes. Mr. Johnson.
The pandemic was perhaps the most extraordinary context and situation that any of us will ever have faced in our lives and will ever face again. Thousands of people lost their lives. So I'm very sorry, but that's not gossip. And I think to suggest that that's why this is being brought forward and being discussed by members of this Parliament is frankly casting aspersions on fellow members, and I reject as strongly as I can some of the assertions made by the previous member. Because we have to understand what decisions were made, on the basis of what information and against what context, because the results of those decisions cost people's lives. Now, we've already heard from Alex Cole-Hamilton about the situation with the care homes. It was perhaps one of the most sensitive periods in the whole pandemic. Over 2,300 excess deaths occurred in care homes in 2020. And we were told time and time again that that decision in April was made because we didn't have knowledge. There was not the science to indicate that asymptomatic transmission may be possible or a significant risk. The problem with that is, if we look at the timeline of published science and published evidence, it doesn't hold up. On the 28th of January 2020, Jim McMenamin, an interim clinical director at the Health Protection Scotland, attended the second meeting of SAGE on COVID-19, and where it was stated, there is limited evidence of asymptomatic transmission, but early indications apply some is occurring. On the 19th of February, the Japanese Institute of Infectious Diseases suggested asymptomatic transmission on the Diamond Princess, which subsequently resulted in other papers which went on to confirm that the majority of transmissions on the Diamond Princess were due to asymptomatic transmission. On the 5th of March, that was confirmed in the New England Journal of Medicine, one of the world's leading journals of medicine. That led, on the 9th of March, to the UK Health Minister, Lord Bethell, telling the Lords that large numbers of people, and I'm quoting, large numbers of people are infectious or infected but are completely asymptomatic and never go near a test kit. Quite simply, those sequences of scientific papers, stated positions in public bodies and indeed parliamentary committees, contradicts and contrasts with the fact that the First Minister at the time and time again, said we did not have the knowledge. So quite simply, what we need to know is this. Was it the case that the government did not have that knowledge, was not looking at that information, at that science, or did it deliberately disregard it? And it's only by looking at the full context of decision-making we can really know that. We need to know whether those hyperlinks to those papers were being shared by officials and ministers within the government. We need to understand that context, because that's the only way we can really understand the nature of those decisions and the consequences that resulted. And let's also be clear, very briefly.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way, but we did know quite a lot at the time. And one of the things we knew was that hospitals in Italy were absolutely swamped with people. And it did seem to a lot of us, including, I think, members across the House, that getting people out of hospital had to be the priority.
The First Minister at the time said time and time again that we did not know that asymptomatic transmission was a risk. And I think we need to understand whether the government was taking cognizance of the latest science at the time or not. Yeah. But look, indeed.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful if you can give him the time back, Presiding Officer. Daniel Johnson is quite right. The minutes of the COVID Advisory Committee of 20th of April 2020 couldn't be clearer. They say, at the one hand, that hospitals were screaming about asymptomatic transmission, and yet the same meeting was hearing about officials moving people out untested or tested positive into Scottish care homes. Those two things were known at the same time. We need to understand why that advice was ignored. Yeah.
Daniel Johnson, I'll give you the time back.
And indeed, we do. And if those facts, if those points raised in those bodies were being discussed in WhatsApp groups, we need to know that. And quite frankly, right now, we don't have the confidence as to whether or not they're going to be, because we have had government positions all over the place as to what would be released. We've had the First Minister saying that everything would be released, that there would be absolute open transparency, right the way through to the fact that the messages were being routinely and systematically deleted. There is, at best, confusion. So to the heart of the motion here, we need an investigation as to whether or not, wittingly or unwittingly, the First Minister misled Parliament. Because, frankly, all of us are profoundly confused as to what the government was retaining and on what basis. Because, again, the government is relying on dancing on the heads of pins on particular words. Time and time again, we hear about relevant information. But quite frankly and simply, it is up to the UK inquiry to decide what is relevant. Why doesn't the Scottish Government trust them? I simply don't understand. It's as though they expect the UK inquiry to break privacy rules, to break the law. They will look at what is handed over. They will judge whether it's relevant. They will judge whether it needs to be redacted. Why don't they trust them? But above all else, we all know in this chamber some simple truths about what happened. And we all know that government decision-making shrank to a very narrow number of ministers and close advisers. We all know that most of the time it was the First Minister and Deputy First Minister under close consultation with key special advisers. Now, I'm not saying that was necessarily the wrong thing to do. These were extraordinary times. It was a crisis. But we need to understand what happened. We need to understand whether that cost lives, because ultimately we need to learn the lessons. This will not be the last time this country faces a crisis. But unless we learn the lessons, lives will be lost again, needlessly, all because this government can't be transparent. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Craig Hoy, around 6 minutes. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Sir Singh also. Making easy political points is not what constituents want to see from their elected representatives. But let me finish. That's not what they want to see, particularly in a debate like this. So, I mean, Douglas Ross's opening comments, when he stated about the about not being party political in this, I would take him on his word at that particular point. But sadly, I think some comments, and certainly some of the barracking from his backbenchers as the debate has went on, and sadly, has went against what Douglas Ross said in his opening comments.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to Stuart McMillan for giving way, and I was genuine that this should be above party politics, which is why I think SNP members and Green members in the government should be independently minded and look at the facts. So can I ask him, looking at all of the details, does he believe the request from the UK COVID inquiry in February for all of the messages constituted a request for those messages, or does he agree with Shona Robison that that only happened in September, just a few weeks ago?
Stuart McMillan, and give you the time back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ross. Mr. Ross, I think that the point of being relevant is really important in this. And I'm sorry, Mr. Ross, we'll have to agree to disagree. So certainly...
Point of order, Daniel Johnson.
Presiding officer, I seek your guidance. The standing orders are very clear in that we must treat each other with respect. So to cast aspersions on the motives and whether or not people are presenting facts and arguments on face value, surely members should respect that and actually consider that other members are speaking in good faith.
I thank Daniel Johnson for his point. I think the debate to date has been fairly respectful. I will intervene if I do not think that is the case. I invite Stuart McMillan to continue and give you the time back, obviously.
Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. So certainly today's debate, I think certainly Scottish Conservatives have put forward obviously kind of what they consider in terms of their opinion, but certainly in my opinion the First Minister and the Scottish Government have been absolutely committed to openness and transparency. Now, the First Minister has been clear that neither he nor the Deputy First Minister have misled Parliament. The Scottish Government has already provided over 19,000 documents to the UK inquiry, in addition to the 14,000 WhatsApp messages. And for absolute clarity, the Scottish Government has and will continue to comply and work with both inquiries. Now, some will try to suggest that these statements are unfair, that the Scottish Government does not appreciate scrutiny. But, Presiding Officer, that could not be further from the truth. Now, I firmly believe that, and know that my SNP colleagues feel the same, the scrutiny is the bedrock that underlies effective governance. But that's why the Scottish Government established the first public inquiry in the UK to examine the response to COVID-19 in December 2021, ahead of the UK Government commencing the UK-wide public inquiry. And at the heart of this motion is the COVID-19 pandemic, which impacted every single one of us and changed our lives indefinitely. Now, John Mason spoke about his own family situation. And my mum went into a care home just over a year ago, obviously not in the COVID period. But it struck me that the care home that my mother went into, actually there was no COVID in that care home throughout the whole COVID period. COVID only started to go in once we actually started to get back into a more normal society. Every government in the world over was taking decisions based upon their own context. And in some countries, their response was driven by scientific understanding, in others, ideological agendas. Now, scientists become the biggest asset to governments during the pandemic, but ultimately, it was up to politicians as to what course of action, what guidance, and what legislation was introduced in response to COVID-19. And as John Mason also touched upon earlier on, day in, day out, in this chamber and committees in this parliament, ministers were being questioned about what their decisions were and also what they were planning to do going forward. And that's why I do believe it's important that we reflect upon on those decisions. We can't speak for other nations, but I believe that the most important way to recognise the loss and suffering of the people of Scotland and the wider UK population during the pandemic is to learn from the evidence. And that does also include the scientific evidence that Daniel Johnson referenced earlier on. I think the inquiries will help identify what could have been done better and to improve government decision-making in a pandemic to save lives and also prevent suffering in the future. And the Scottish Government is already committed to examining and considering closely the recommendations that both the Scottish and UK public inquiries make. Now, to go back to today's motion, in one of my opening statements, the Scottish Government has provided already over 19,000 documents to the UK inquiry, which is over and above the 14,000 WhatsApp messages handed over. Since December 2022, the Scottish Government has been assisting the inquiry by providing a large volume of evidence to the inquiry team, including corporate and individual statements and extensive documentation. So the Scottish Government has to date provided 25 detailed corporate statements and has also been involved in the request for 89 individual statements.
Liam Kerr.
Grateful. Does the member not have a concern, at least, that it is the Scottish Government making a decision on what is relevant and what is not relevant to disclose?
Stuart McMillan.
I think some of the examples we heard from John Mason actually probably indicate the issue regarding relevance. Once again, let me be clear, there has never been any hesitation by former members of the Scottish Government to provide all the information that they hold. And when appropriately and legally requested by the UK and Scottish inquiries, the Scottish Government has and will continue to cooperate fully. Now, the Deputy First Minister has already set out that in examining the content of WhatsApp messages previously, it became clear that they did hold some sensitive personal data, which means that under data protection legislation, there must be a clear legal basis for providing that information. And that is why the Scottish Government requested the Section 21 notice, which would give that legal basis for the provision. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Conservatives can't excuse the behaviour and actions of... we've all heard some of the examples that happened during the pandemic down at Westminster. So, gently, I would suggest that I would urge them to try to convince... I would gently suggest that they try to actually convince their colleagues in Westminster to actually try and behave somewhat differently in contrast to certainly the colleagues that we have here in this Scottish Parliament. But the reality is, Presiding Officer, that the Scottish Government's messages handed over to the UK COVID-19 inquiry will be starkly different to those of Westminster politicians. Unlike the UK Government's attempts to limit the chair of the inquiry, Baroness Hallett's request for information, the Scottish Government has always committed to fully cooperate with the UK inquiry and also the Scottish public inquiries. So going back to the Section 21 notice, this was received on Monday the 30th of October and actioned in line with the UK inquiry's deadline of Monday the 6th of October. The Scottish Government has consistently acted in line with its records management policies and relevant legal obligations with regard to collating and storing corporate information. And so to conclude, saying also, I truly hope that the public see through some of what we've actually heard today from some of the Conservatives, but also with regards to the motion. I generally believe it's nothing more than an attempt to deflect from what we've seen in Westminster in comparison to what we've seen here in Scotland. And with that, saying also, I will close. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. I now call Craig Hoy to be followed by Fulton McGregor around 5 minutes. Mr Hoy.
Deputy Presiding Officer, this SNP government rightly and richly deserves the wretched reputation it has earned when it comes to its record on transparency. This secretive government picks and chooses how and when it engages with issues of significant legal and public interest. It is self-evident and beyond reasonable doubt that Humza Yousaf and Shona Robison have misled the Scottish Parliament. They made and repeated false and misleading claims about when the UK COVID inquiry requested crucial WhatsApp messages. Grieving families are rightly demanding answers, and they deserve them. But sadly, this government will not give them all they need to know to bring justice and closure. Transparency, and as a result, the truth, are defined as optional extras in the SNP's cynical political playbook. So let's look at the evidence before us. In June 2021, the UK government wrote to the Scottish government requesting that it does not destroy material relevant to the UK COVID inquiry. 2 months later, Nicola Sturgeon announced that a separate Scottish COVID inquiry where she said, nothing, quotes, will be off limits to the Scottish government when it comes to providing information. How shallow that sounds now. By December, John Swinney, who now appears as a Praetorian bodyguard accompanying the spectral figure of Nicola Sturgeon around this Parliament, said this, I pledge that the Scottish Government will engage, as I know this Parliament and everyone in Scotland will, to support Lady Poole in this most important inquiry. In August 2022, the Scottish COVID inquiry wrote to the Scottish Government requesting that information relevant to the pandemic is retained. That November, the UK COVID inquiry asked the Scottish Government about potentially relevant messages, including WhatsApp messages, during the pandemic. And in February 2022, the UK COVID inquiry explicitly asked the Scottish Government for any WhatsApp messages relating to key decisions made during the pandemic. Let's note the wording here, relating to. That means messages involving discussions around and discussion about those decisions, even when those decisions were made elsewhere. The fact that decisions may be formally taken in a different forum or in a different context cannot cynically become the government's default defence for deleting and withholding important WhatsApp messages relating to these decisions. This June, Humza Yousaf said that all material which was asked for by the inquiry would be provided. Over the summer, requests for WhatsApps were sent to individual ministers, former ministers and civil servants within the Scottish Government. And yet the First Minister and his deputy still claim they were first requested in September. That was plainly untrue. Their attempt to deflect involves a claim that, they had interpreted earlier requests too narrowly. Deputy Presiding Officer, this simply does not stack up. In August, the Scottish Government had already confirmed the existence of WhatsApp groups used by the Scottish Government to the UK COVID inquiry. They conceded that they existed, but they still wouldn't hand over those messages. And for clarity, let's not forget what Humza Yousaf said in June, that WhatsApp messages, emails, Signal messages, Telegram messages, or whatever, will, and I quote, absolutely be handed over to the COVID inquiries and handed over to them in full. So how can this possibly be consistent with reports that the former First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, deleted her WhatsApp messages despite earlier assurance from her to the contrary? And this follows a pattern of deflection, diversion, distraction, deletion, and at times outright deceit. Presiding Officer, Deputy Presiding Officer, a review of similar events proves a pattern of behaviour which supports our motion. SNP government officials held deposit return scheme meetings verbally to avoid correspondence being obtained through freedom of information requests. During Alex Salmond's judicial review, the SNP government's own legal counsel admitted that they could not advise the court that the Scottish Government had discharged its duty of candour. The Salmond Inquiry Committee found the SNP Government's refusal to hand over documents had impeded its scrutiny function. Nicola Sturgeon admitted that there were no minutes of notes of a crucial meeting with former Ferguson Marine owner Jim McCall. The SNP Government refused to reveal the outcome of a bullying probe into one of its own ministers. And this month, the Health Secretary, Michael Matheson, agreed to pay back £11,000 in roaming charges 10 months after they were paid by the taxpayer, but only after that scandal hit the headlines. This is the SNP's track record on transparency, and they should be ashamed. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's ministerial code said ministers should resign if they knowingly mislead Parliament. And we will only know this if Humza Yousaf and Shona Robison refer themselves to the ministerial advisor, the independent advisor on the ministerial code.
Thank you. I now call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Russell Finlay at around 6 minutes. Mr McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It has now been nearly 4 years since the health professionals first took notice of a novel virus outbreak in China. In the months that followed, governments around the world scrambled to mitigate the health, social and economic effects of this unprecedented situation. Those here in Scotland were asked to make sacrifices to ensure those who were most vulnerable were shielded from the worst of the pandemic before the heroic effort to develop and procure a vaccine was completed. Despite these efforts, many families found themselves bereaved through this pandemic, and my sympathies to John Mason, who shared his own story today. Many more are still suffering the effects of long COVID, and the overall pandemic and repeated lockdowns has taken a toll on the health, education and well-being of the population, which is currently difficult to quantify. Because of this severe effect that the pandemic has had, it is right that we learn from the evidence of that time to find out what we could have done better. This will also improve government decision-making in any potential future pandemic to save lives and prevent suffering. Not only will this help us all in the future, but it is also an important way to recognise the loss and suffering of the people of Scotland and of the wider UK population during the last few years. It was for these reasons that the Scottish Government established the first public inquiry in the UK to examine the response to COVID-19 in December 21, which was ahead of the UK Government commencing the UK-wide public inquiry. Showing the initiative to establish this inquiry underlines the Scottish Government's commitment to openness and transparency and recognises that scrutiny is the bedrock that underlies effective governance. And
Douglas Ross.
The member has just said that scrutiny underlines the integrity of government decisions. Does he not then welcome the scrutiny that would be offered by the independent advisor on the ministerial code to either prove or otherwise the version of events of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister?
Fulton McGregor, and give the time back.
I thank the member for that intervention. He's heard what the Deputy First Minister said, and I welcome her response to that. And on this point, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government have and will continue to cooperate with both the Scottish and the UK-wide inquiry on the pandemic. A huge volume of data has already been provided to the UK inquiry. Nearly 20,000 documents have been passed on, and that's not including the nearly 15,000 WhatsApp messages which have been sent in addition to those documents. And as you can imagine, that's a huge amount of data. And in managing this data, the Scottish Government has consistently acted in line with its data management policies and relevant legal obligations concerning the collecting and keeping of this information. The Scottish Government Records Management Policy is ensuring material relevant to either of the COVID inquiries is retained. The Scottish Government recognises the importance of data storage, and records management processes have been established for recording decisions made by ministers and officials which form part of the Scottish Government corporate record. And importantly, this also covers messaging applications such as WhatsApp, which has been a key talking point in this debate thus far. No, I've already taken one. Apologies, Mr Green. Indeed, the nuance in this debate centres around the requesting of a Section 21 notice with regard to WhatsApp messages. The Deputy First Minister has already clarified that personal data was present in the data, and as such, a clear legal basis was needed to provide that data. Following data protection guidelines, the Scottish Government requested this Section 21 notice, which was received just over 2 weeks ago. This action was to comply with the Data Protection Act 2018 using mechanisms found in the Inquiries Act 2005. The Scottish Government confirmed with a deadline to provide the messages to the inquiry, and all messages were given to the inquiry on the 6th of November. I'd like to make some progress. Any assertions about these messages may or may not contain is conjecture at this point, and it is important that all of those in the chamber and beyond allow the inquiry to determine the importance of the content of these messages. The bottom line is that the Scottish Government has acted legally and has and will continue to cooperate fully with both inquiries. And I should also say that the readiness of the Scottish Government to hand over WhatsApp messages should be commended by everyone in this chamber. And I would maybe just gently say to the members on my left that everybody, all governments involved in an inquiry, should show the same readiness, because at the end of the day, what we all must remember is that both inquiries Both inquiries is about the real people who want answers. The real people's businesses and organisations in our constituencies who were affected by a whole array of decisions made or not made, as the case may be. Those in care homes have already been discussed. Children in schools, those suffering, I'm not taking any more interventions, those suffering from long COVID, businesses that closed and never recovered. These are the people that we all must keep in our minds. There should be no party politics here. We have heard this before. There should be absolutely no party politics in this debate at all. And the inquiries should be allowed to do their work and get the answers that the public deserve and need. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Claire Adamson, around 5 minutes. Mr Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. Today, Parliament's using its time to talk about something that matters and has the power to do something about. We're talking about government secrecy, specifically about the desperate lengths the SNP go to in order to shut down legitimate and important public scrutiny. They should have preserved and handed over their WhatsApp messages to the COVID inquiry. But instead, they have chosen to be slippery and evasive. Presiding Officer, this all feels familiar. This is not the first time the SNP have run for the shadows when faced with the disinfecting sunlight of scrutiny. It was the exact same playbook they used during the Alex Salmond inquiry. Now, as then, they hide behind process. They delay, dodge and stonewall. They prevaricate, misremember and misrepresent. They deploy sophistry and selective amnesia, bad faith and bluster, point blank refusing to do the right thing. It's a broad spectrum of deceit, from the political equivalent of the dog ate my homework right through to a low cunning that would make Machiavelli blush. Presiding Officer, it was as painful and infuriating to watch then as a member of the public as it is now as an MSP. Back then, they failed alleged victims of sexual harassment by their former leader. Now, they are failing grieving families who lost loved ones to COVID. Both groups treated with disrespect, considered to be of less value to an SNP that will always prioritise the good of the party over the common good. Let's compare events. With the Salmond inquiry, they promised to cooperate fully, they promised transparency, they promised to freely hand over any and all material, just as they now do with the COVID inquiry. But what's happened then and what's happening now? Back then, Nicola Sturgeon held numerous meetings with Salmond while he was being investigated over sexual harassment complaints. No records were taken, or they may have been destroyed. We don't know for sure. And now, Sturgeon and others may have reportedly deleted WhatsApp messages. We don't know how many messages. We don't know what they said. It's likely that the people of Scotland will never know. With the Salmond inquiry, the SNP tried to prevent the release of documents. The inquiry complained of being obstructed. Let's not forget, this included SNP MSPs and the SNP convener. For the first time ever, Parliament had to resort to using a Section 23 order to force the release of documents. With the COVID inquiry, we see the same secretive agenda. Key evidence has to be dragged out of them. The inquiry has been asking for WhatsApp messages for more than a year. Then there are the shifting sands, the changing of stories. In the Salmond inquiry, four senior government officials had to correct false statements. The SNP's then chief executive was accused of perjury after contradicting his own evidence three times. And in relation to COVID, Humza Yousaf, who really should be here today, and Shona Robison have been forced to change their story after the inquiry demanded that they correct the record to this Parliament. Then, There are the stalling tactics. In the Salmond inquiry, they delayed everything until the last minute. Access to crucial legal advice was refused time and time again in defiance of two votes in here. It was only when my party brought a vote of no confidence in John Swinney, then Deputy First Minister, that some of the advice was finally released. We see the same with the COVID inquiry. Now, as then, it is up to the Scottish Conservatives to use every parliamentary lever available to us. Now, as then, the SNP have misled and disrespected Parliament. They also disrespect the people of Scotland. So, MSPs from every party, and including the SNP, can today join us in holding them to account by backing our motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Martin Whitfield, around 6 minutes. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start with a quote. I was a bit worried earlier on. I had a lot of my speech Alex Cole Hamilton had used in his speech, but it's a quote from Nicola Sturgeon round about the start of the COVID crisis. I understand, because I'm First Minister leading a government, how difficult and unprecedented this situation is. We are all trying to make the best decisions. We will undoubtedly get things wrong along the way, as every government across the world will be. And I've been very clear about that from the outset. I'll make mistakes. Everybody involved in leading the responses will make mistakes. But it's really important that we take the best decisions we can at every single stage, and to learn from that as we go. I remember that time so vividly because it had such a profound effect on me, on my constituents, on my family, on my friends and my relatives who died at that time in difficult circumstances. And that's what we should be talking about today. It's about the people and the effect that COVID had on them. Now, I remember sitting in a room upstairs with many of the people that are in this chamber today, with briefings from Jason Leach, from the Chief Medical Officer, who were open and transparent, willing to answer any of the questions in the rooms that we had about the policies that the Scottish Government were taking to try and keep people safe. Now, I don't remember anyone at that time making comments that they distrusted the medical officer, the Chief Medical Officer, Jason Leach, that they were not all thinking that we were in this together. And I remember that there were never any suggestions that there was going to be a policy to get herd immunity and that the bodies could pile high at that time. Everybody was concentrating on what the inquiry is about and what today should have been about in this Parliament. People getting the answers that they deserve, that are needed, and that the learning from this experience can be taken forward, because we don't know when there might be another crisis like this and there might be another pandemic. Now, the tone of this debate has been completely wrong, completely wrong. There's a pantomime villain being sought from across the opposition benches. But what is in truth is this is just everybody having to adapt around COVID, to work differently, to communicate differently, and to try and do the best that they could. So my team introduced WhatsApp. We introduced Slack at that time. We were trying to do the very best to ensure that we still were able to provide a service to our constituents in the most difficult of circumstances. The Scottish Government is complying with the inquiry. It has already provided 19,000 documents in addition to 14,000 WhatsApp messages, in line with their own policy on how decision-making should have been recorded at that time. And I think, I can't believe we're hearing this. I remember when there was a crisis at that time, when Catherine Calderwood had a mistake that was unforgivable and she lost her job over it. And at the same time, what we were seeing at Westminster was Dominic Cummings going on family trips to Barnard Castle. and treating people with absolute contempt. And I know that the WhatsApp messages that have come out in the COVID inquiry from what the atmosphere was at Downing Street will be really hard for the Conservative benches and really, really not edifying in any way whatsoever to see the contempt in which some of the civil servants were treating the politicians, the contempt in which some of the decisions were being made, and the attitude that people, the individual people affected by this, were not being given the prominence that they deserved. So there's been a lot said today about the context and the nature in which these decisions were being made. And I know there are people that won't agree with me, but I believe that the context of the decisions that were made in Scotland with the team of medical experts that we had, with the First Minister at that time, and the transparency she showed every single day, standing up to scrutiny of the press in marked contract to Boris Johnson at the time, that those decisions were made in the very best interests of the people of Scotland. But that's not for us to judge. It's not for the people on this bench. It's not for the people on those benches to judge. It's for the people of Scotland to look at what happened and to take their own decisions about who they trust, who they did trust at that time, where they were looking to get their information from. And it wasn't the briefings from Downing Street. That's absolutely true. Presiding officer, I don't think this has helped the families at all affected by this, and I regret that that's had to happen here this afternoon. This has been a pantomime. It's been a look for a pantomime villain that doesn't exist. It's been implausible. It's been political point scoring from the party that partied all the way through COVID. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Emma Harper, around 6 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a pleasure to take part in this debate this afternoon. And if I can find agreement with the previous speaker, Claire Adamson, it is that this is about the people. This is about the people of Scotland. And to agree with Fulton MacGregor, this is not party politics. This is, at its foundation, what we stood to be parliamentarians about, what we encompass in our standing orders about events taking place in public, what we encompass in our guidance to MSPs on their general conduct, what the Scottish Ministerial Code seeks to embody in what we expect to see from our government. And it goes back to 1995. It goes back to when the Standards in Public Life Committee were founded, chaired by Lord Nolan. And they were asked to say, why is it that the public are losing confidence in politicians? And that committee sat and it took evidence. And before, in all honesty, most of us entered a professional political life in 1995, they founded the seven principles that are drawn to the attention of MSPs, if not quite on the first day that you come to this chamber, certainly in that first week of induction. The same seven principles that are pointed at by our councillors who serve in local authorities, to our MPs who go to Westminster, within the health boards, within the emanations of the state, of what the expectation is on you if you stand up and speak for people or a subset of the people of Scotland, be it at a constituency level or be it at a regional level. It talks about selflessness. It talks about integrity. It talks about objectivity. Objectivity. That we're impartial. That we are fair and we judge on merit. And that we use the best evidence and without discrimination. It talks about accountability. And I thank Douglas Ross for allowing my intervention. Because holders of public office are accountable to the public for their decisions and their actions, and they must submit themselves to the scrutiny necessary to ensure this. It is not just about taking decisions. It is not just about taking the right decision. It is about being open to saying, I took this decision because, and hold me to account.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Martin Whitfield for taking the intervention. Does he agree with me that Claire Adamson's speech just there reflected a time where I think that the First Minister had a certain degree of latitude in this chamber for the decisions that she took, a blank check, as it were, because we were in uncharted and scary waters, and that as a result of that blank check, she should, with confidence, provide all of the material around the decisions that she took, because there should be nothing to hide?
Martin Whitfield can give you the time.
I'm very grateful for that intervention. And indeed, the circumstances of COVID put to test the democratic settlement that you have with the electorate and with the country. And I think it proves the worth of those Nolan principles, that it is in the very hardest of moments that you need to look back at what makes it different to other less democratic states, that makes it different from a dictatorship. It is the ability to be accountable. It is the ability to be open. It's the ability to be honest. And it is the ability to show leadership. And we've heard on many occasions across this chamber and discussions within this parliament about the role of leadership, that we are leaders in our community. We turn to our young people and ask them to be leaders in the school. The Nolan principles require holders of public office should exhibit these principles, those I've mentioned, in their own behaviour. They should actively promote, robustly support the principles, and be willing to challenge poor behaviour wherever it occurs. And that is important, because if we look at the Scottish Ministerial Code, the First Minister, our current First Minister, echoed previous ministerial codes, but said, and I quote, "As First Minister, I have promised to lead Scotland in the interests of all our people," the people that Claire Adamson spoke about, "and work to earn," and this is the important bit, "re-earn the respect and trust of the people of Scotland." Goes on, "That is why I am pleased to issue these ministerial code, which sets the highest standards of propriety and transparency for government ministers. All Scottish ministers, including myself, are bound by their terms to ensure integrity, accountability and honesty at every level of leadership. And I will lead by example." The key message when the Nolan principles were reviewed was that many of those whose integrity have been called into question in recent months and years seemed to have behaved inappropriately. Not because they were unaware of what was expected, the Nolan principles, but because they did not find it expedient. High standards of behaviour need to be understood as a matter of personal responsibility. The debate today speaks to that. The debate today speaks to why we sit in this parliament. The debate speaks to what the Scottish Government owe the people that Claire Adamson spoke about. Lord Evans, the current chair, has said the damage done to the trust and confidence that the public have in those in political and public life has been significant. Well, let's end it now here in Scotland. Let us show that we stand by those Nolan principles, even when it is not expedient. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Ros McCall, around 6 minutes. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just listening to what has been said so far, Presiding Officer, I want to make a few key points in this debate. And what Claire Adamson said about what the former First Minister said is absolutely relevant and appropriate. And I think we absolutely must remember the work of Nicola Sturgeon and Jean Freeman, of course, and Jason Leach and Gregor Smith. They put work in every day when we were witnessing what was happening on our television screens about the pandemic across the globe. And I can see already folk are going to be on their feet every 2 minutes, Presiding Officer, no matter what we say. You know, the first thing that is vital that we learn from and reflect on is our experience of the pandemic, and that we obtain answers for those who lost loved ones over the course of the pandemic. And we've already heard members reflect on their own experience of losing loved ones. And I think we need to make sure that we help families that are still grieving, absolutely. And it's so important that we make sure that the inquiries, both the Scottish one and the UK inquiries, go ahead and are clear and transparent and engaging. And I want to remind Chamber that I worked as a nurse during the pandemic, giving vaccines to my colleagues and also members of the public. So this was during a time when we had lockdown. Just after lockdown, we had the virus, the first COVID vaccines. We were right there on the front line. So I think we need to remember what happened back then so that we can look at see how we can improve the way that we tackle any future outbreaks of whatever virus and whatever pandemic, whatever crisis we face. The people who lost their lives are not just statistics, presiding officer, and our condolences should again go to all the victims of COVID-19. I will take an intervention.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Emma Harper for giving way. She's right. Those people are not just statistics. They have families, and those families are looking for answers. Those answers are not forthcoming and will not be forthcoming unless we have a complete picture of the backroom discussions that underpinned all of the decisions that she's described.
Emma Harper, and I'll give you the time back.
Aye, OK. Thank you for that, Alec Cole-Hamilton. One of the things that I was reflecting on about this and about the messages is that the Scottish Government has a policy for mobile phones and records management so that when that was introduced, it is also the responsibility, I'm going to read from it right here, that it does not change the responsibility within the Scottish Government to maintain complete and comprehensive records of key conversations and decisions. So all of that information is already there. So I think, you know, if I move on to my second point, Presiding Officer, is that the Scottish Government is committed to openness and transparency and recognises that scrutiny is the bedrock that underlines effective governance. And Stuart McMillan mentioned that as well. And it's a point that has been evidenced and emphasised by the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, as well as other ministers and officials within the Scottish Government. Indeed, the fact that the Scottish Government was the first to establish an independent public inquiry in the UK on COVID-19 ahead of the UK Government commencing their inquiry is testament to the importance of the Scottish Government that the Scottish Government puts on scrutiny. Presiding Officer, the most important way to recognise the loss and suffering of the people of Scotland and the wider UK population during this pandemic is to learn from the evidence. And both inquiries will help what could have been done differently, and they will serve to improve government decision-making in any future pandemic or viral outbreak or any other crisis. And we want to make sure that we can focus on how we can save lives and prevent suffering in the future. As the First Minister has said, the Scottish Government will examine and consider closely the recommendations that both the Scottish and the UK public inquiries make. You know, we need to let the inquiries progress. That would be the normal thing to do, to allow the inquiries to progress. Contrary to what the Conservative motion states, the Scottish Government has and will continue to fully comply with both inquiries. Scottish ministers, including the First and Deputy First Minister and officials, have already provided a large volume of information, and members have outlined that already. And we know that the Scottish Government has to date provided 25 detailed corporate statements and has been involved in the request for 89 individual statements in support of Module 2A. So, you know, in turning to the Scottish Government's amendment, Presiding Officer, there has never been any hesitation by former members of the Government of the Scottish Government to provide any and all information they hold. And again, this is crucially important in order to learn lessons and understand how the handling of pandemics can be improved in the future. I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer, and I'm conscious of the constant chuntering that we're hearing from over there, because this is just something that I'm concerned also about is, you know, the former Prime Minister, the UK Prime Minister, didn't only drag the UK inquiry through court, but Boris Johnson has still refused to hand over his own WhatsApp messages. You know, and unlike the UK government's attempts to also limit the chair of the inquiry, Barnes Hallett's request for information, the Scottish Government has already committed
point
to
of
fully
order, Jamie
cooperate
Halker-Johnston.
With the UK inquiry. So, okay, thank you.
Point
for
of order,
officer,
Jamie Halker-Johnston. apologise for point of order. I don't think it should go on record that the chuntering that the member referred to was actually members trying to intervene in a debate when interventions weren't being taken, not chuntering. And I think it's important that's recorded.
Thank you, Mr. Halgrove-Johnston. It's not a point of order, but your comments are on the record. Ms. Harper, you have concluded?
Yes, I have concluded, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Ros McCall to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to take my 5 minutes to highlight to the Chamber just why we should be debating deleted messages, why trust in this process should not and cannot be eroded, and disappointing as it is that this motion is needed in the first place, that any misleading of this Parliament should be taken with the utmost severity. We focus on the COVID-19 pandemic, and rightly so. A new viral infection that hit the world and took loved ones from us. Families grieving from government decisions made on how to deal with the pandemic and the many ramifications of those choices. People all over the country put their faith and trust in their government to see them through a global infection. They trusted the people elected to this place to make decisions to keep them safe. Not decisions for political gain or for self-promotion, but decisions that followed science and that were altruistic at heart. That's the only way that people can accept the unintended consequences from the restrictions imposed. My father was diagnosed with esophageal cancer in April 2020. He passed away in October of that year as the cancer had spread to his lungs and his liver. In any other time, he would have been given instant treatment. Exploratory processes would have been administered, and the chances of prolonging his life for even a short time would have been discussed. In his case, they were not. The country was in lockdown. COVID effects had altered the priorities of our NHS. The treatment offered was curtailed, and he instantly went to management, not medicine. My mum, living in a different council and health board region to me, was left to carry the burden of this without my in-person support. Now, I am not unique. This happened to people across the country, and just like me, many could not travel to see dying loved ones under decisions made in Scotland by this SNP-run Scottish government. These people deserve accurate and truthful information and answers from a full and transparent COVID inquiry. Yeah. My mum certainly does. Any ambiguity or lack of transparency does all the grieving families a disservice. Yep. Whether they are grieving from COVID-19 itself or other diseases affected by changes in NHS practices, the people deserve to know the whole truth. Absolutely. And that means all forms of communication, trivial or not, need to be assessed and their relevancy accounted. If any further clarity is needed on that fact, in June of this year, the First Minister agreed when he said, to ensure that there is simply no doubt whatsoever, any material that is asked for, WhatsApp messages, emails, Signal messages, Telegram messages, or whatever, will absolutely be handed over to the COVID inquiries and handed over in full. Yep. Yep. That statement must be followed if we are to know if the unintended consequences affecting ongoing health treatments and children's development and people's mental health and disrupted education for a generation of young people were all worth it. And the many thousands of families who suffered loss will get the answers they deserve. So why, when the UK COVID inquiry explicitly asked for any WhatsApp messages in February 2023, were they not provided in full? I will give way.
John Mason.
Would she accept that they only asked in February 23 for relevant messages?
Ros McCall.
And again, we're right back to relevant messages. It is up to the inquiry to decide what is relevant. Why, 8 months later, in October 2023, did the Scottish Government force the UK inquiry to issue a Section 21 notice to retrieve messages? Why were the messages deleted by individuals? Why was the First Minister's statement of June 2023 not followed to the letter? This is not just a matter of process. This is about people and their need for answers. Presiding Officer, when my husband had a stroke in another lockdown period, he was in another council and health board region for over 3 months, so we couldn't see each other. Lockdown restrictions also meant that I shouldn't have crossed the boundary between Forth Valley and Lothian Health Boards. But given that restrictions also meant I wasn't allowed to pass a bag of clothing from one person to another for fear of contamination, I was advised by doctors at that time it would be okay to drive to the hospital as long as I came alone, wiped down the bag, wore gloves and a face mask. Now, I consider myself lucky because I could, in a small way, let my husband know that I was there for him. Others were not so lucky. People in hospitals were left isolated, lonely, and in some cases scared, sitting in a hospital chair, in a hospital gown, alone. Too many people over Scotland coped with the decisions made in this place, are living with the consequences of decisions made in this place, and lost family members for decisions made in this place. They deserve accurate and truthful information to be provided. And any misleading statements given to Parliament by the First Minister and the Deputy First Number do not only break the ministerial code, but they shame the Scottish people and they misplaced their trust. And therefore, I support the motion in Douglas Ross's name.
I call Ben McPherson, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today, of course, we are discussing very serious matters, and I commend colleagues for their contributions, some of which have been very powerful. As I think back to the period of the pandemic, like colleagues, I recall and think of all those who suffered in my constituency and across the country, particularly those who lost loved ones and are mourning every day for those people in their lives. I think of those in the NHS who had to cope with the pandemic at the time, those who worked in our care homes, those who were lonely, the economic disruption, the closure of our schools. It was all very difficult for everyone. And because of those circumstances and the way they affected everyone and made such significant impacts on people's lives that they're still living with today, it is absolutely vital that we learn from those difficult years and reflect on our experience. And that is why the Scottish Government established the first public inquiry in the UK to examine the response to COVID-19 in December 2021. That was ahead of the UK Government commencing the UK-wide public inquiry, and both are extremely important. Because the best way to recognise and the most appropriate way to respond to the loss and suffering of the people of Scotland and the wider UK population is that we learn, and we learn from the evidence. These inquiries are being undertaken with diligence and extremely high levels of commitment and will help identify what could have been done better and to improve government decision-making in a pandemic, if there is one in future years, to save lives and prevent further suffering. And there are also lessons to learn when it comes to responding to other circumstances. Of course, the decision-making process in the UK was initially based on the advice of SAGE, as others have said, and it was a very integrated network of advice and information that was passed across the UK nations. It has been stated by ministers that the Scottish Government will examine closely the recommendations that both the Scottish and UK public inquiries make. And that is something that we should all be focused on learning from, not just from those recommendations in those inquiries, but also to consider what we can learn from elsewhere. The Scottish Government has been clear that it will continue to cooperate fully with both inquiries. As the Deputy First Minister stated earlier in today's debate, the Scottish Government has already provided a large volume of information to both the Scottish and UK inquiries and will continue to provide more as appropriate. As has been set out, the Scottish Government has already provided over 19,000 documents to the UK inquiry, in addition to thousands of WhatsApp messages. And I think the fact that 19,000 documents have already provided shows and demonstrates the diligence that the civil service paid to making sure that decisions were recorded and that advice that was considered was appropriately recorded, as you would expect. I'm going to take one. Mr. Sarwar.
Anna Sarwar.
Can I thank Ben McPherson for giving way, but also the tone and manner in which he has addressed the debate. I think it's very, very welcome. Would you agree, though, that ultimately it is for the judge of any inquiry rather than the participants or the subjects of any inquiry, the judge, to decide what is relevant and what is not?
Ben McPherson.
I do, and I think there's a shared position on that in the room. But also I would emphasise that the Scottish Government is committed to openness and transparency, and every day responds to scrutiny, whether it's freedom of information requests, and I'm sure the Minister will refer to these points when he's summing up. There's a really robust professional process within the government that on a regular basis, and especially during the pandemic, is making sure that it's responding to the requirements on it. And you know, these points around record management are extremely important, and it's right that we're thinking about them together. And it's right that we are also doing that in a time where, let's remember, as others rightly stated during this debate, there was a change in technology and the circumstances of the pandemic were all relevant to the considerations here. Presiding Officer, in my final moments in this debate, I just want to focus on something that's not been said by others. And that's this. The civil service did a remarkable job during the pandemic. People worked long hours every week with commitment, tenacity, innovation, and determination to serve the people of Scotland, along with other services, of course, like the NHS and all the services that we rightly commend. But let's not forget that the commitment that government officials made, whether it was making sure that decision-making happened in a timorous manner by briefing ministers as best as they could and the scientists that were involved in that, whether it was the working with local authorities to get money to businesses, all the difficult considerations that took place required the highest level of public service. And I think we should remember that when we are in this chamber and considering these important points.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Jackie Bailey. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The benefit of being in this Parliament for so long is you get to see patterns of behaviour over time. The last 16 years of the SNP have indeed been instructive. What I have learnt is that these are not isolated incidents or even, at the most generous interpretation, mistakes. This is a systematic approach to government, and it is an approach characterised by secrecy and a lack of transparency. So a bit of reflection might be useful. Let me take you back to the Parliament's Committee on Handling of Harassment Complaints, for shorthand, the Salmon Committee. The war that went on to get information from the government. WhatsApp and text messages discovered only after several requests. The lack of information on the legal advice taken by the Scottish Government, in which counsel said the case should be abandoned because they were going to lose, never mind the cost to the taxpayer. Months of argument, and ultimately, motions of no confidence in this chamber for John Swinney to finally give a sight of some of the documents required. And I have to say, the approach to the COVID inquiry bears remarkable similarity. The government tell us how many thousands of pages they have supplied, but not the quality of the information. With the Salmon inquiry, many of the thousands of pages we were provided with were either blank or so heavily redacted, all you could see were black lines. Secrecy is the SNP's modus operandi. Look at Ferguson's and the award of that disastrous shipbuilding contract, information withheld from the Parliament's Audit Committee. Or what about Circularity Scotland, created so ministers did not need to be answerable for decisions about the bottle return scheme? And so it goes on. I am reminded that Nicola Sturgeon first committed to a public inquiry in May 2020, and I commend her for that. She knew then and subsequently confirmed that she would disclose all government emails, private emails and WhatsApp messages to the inquiry. And frankly, I find it appalling that this has not been complied with and that she appears to have manually deleted messages, a point on which she is unwilling to confirm or deny. It would appear that deleting messages, though, has been going on an industrial scale, and not just by politicians. We have Jason Leach, the National Clinical Director, was at it too. So let me just ask, how many messages from Jason Leach or Nicola Sturgeon or John Swinney or Hamza Youssef have been transcribed to the official record, as the Deputy First Minister said they would be? Then there is the First Minister and his old mobile phone, and I'm delighted that he found it and is handing it over. Can he possibly tell us, through whoever's replying for the government, were the inquiry told that they were initially missing? And is it only because he discovered an old mobile that he can now provide messages? And can ministers hand over emails from their SNP email accounts? I know they use them as a means of avoiding scrutiny. Have any of these been handed over to the inquiry? And from which ministers and special advisers? Now, I welcome the provision of all legal advice being handed over to the UK inquiry. Can the Deputy First Minister confirm that this is without qualification? After all, it should be for the inquiry to judge what is relevant, not those who have a vested interest in protecting themselves in terms of the outcome. And it's not just individuals that have withheld information, it's the government itself. And I understand a key document on the decision to send older people untested into care homes appears to have gone missing. I genuinely think that the SNP government, particularly ministers, have decided, and this is how cynical it is, that to be criticised for being secretive and not sharing information is better than to reveal the content of those messages. It is so disappointing that the Scottish Government have told half-truths and had to be invited to correct the record by the UK COVID inquiry. It is embarrassing. As Amar Anwar, representing the family, said, the Scottish Government's failure to provide clarity, constant changing timelines and excuses, combined with the redundant excuse of confidentiality, inflames a belief that you are obstructing the search for truth. I couldn't agree with him more. But I want to turn to the comments made by the First Minister and Deputy First Minister in this chamber. In May and at least twice in June, the First Minister promises to be open and transparent. It will all be absolutely handed over to the COVID inquiries and handed over to them in full. In October, in full became any potentially relevant information, with the greatest respect that for the inquiry to decide is absolutely essential, and it's not for government to decide. And it's clear from the exchanges on the 31st of October and the 2nd of November that there are entirely contradictory timelines and information provided by the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister. It would appear to anybody watching this that the ministerial code has been breached. The question for me is, was it a genuine mistake or is it a deliberate attempt to cover up? And I have to say, given what I have seen over the years, secrecy trumps all with this government. This should be referred for investigation to consider whether Parliament has been misled. Presiding Officer, this is an important debate. It is about accountability and standards in public office, as Martin Whitfield spoke about. And importantly, it is about getting truth and justice for COVID bereaved families, for the older people discharged to care homes without testing, to the families unable to visit loved ones in care, for the children whose education was compromised and are still suffering the consequences of that today. All of them deserve answers. This is a matter of trust and accountability. And I have to say in closing that I am so disappointed with the Deputy First Minister's amendment. It fails to apologise or even acknowledge that they have given incorrect information to this chamber. It is complacent and it is insulting to those who lost loved ones. I finish, Presiding Officer, by repeating what Anas Sawar said at the end of his comments. What do the SNP have to hide?
I call on George Adam, up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And Presiding Officer, I'll spend most of my time going through the various points brought up by colleagues here today. But Presiding Officer, can I start with the reassurances that the First Minister and Deputy First Minister have provided over some time now are compelling and informed.
During this debate, Fulke McGregor brought up what was an extremely important point, where it is up to both inquiries, as they are the ones who will make the decisions and the answers that everyone else is looking for. And all communications that we have demonstrate the care and close attention being given to the huge task of ensuring that both inquiries receive the information they have requested and require in order to provide comfort to those whom COVID-19 hit hardest. Like the Deputy First Minister, I am thoughtful of the impact of all our discussions I have on the Scottish COVID bereaved families, and my thoughts are with all those who experienced a loss during the pandemic. Claire Adamson, in an extremely powerful speech, mentioned about how it was people and not statistics that we were talking about. And in this debate, I think it's extremely important that we talk about the sheer humanity of the situation. And every single one of us, presiding officer, has a COVID story. And everyone has, as we've heard today, someone in their family who's affected with. In my case, it was 2 years ago, my mother-in-law ended up in the Royal Alexander Hospital. And it's probably 2 years to the past couple of weeks since we had our funeral. And I'm aware how triggering these debates are, and we have to be respectful. We have to do it in a way because, in all honesty, I care about what these people think about what went on. I think they are the most important, and these families are the most important people in this debate. So, like Claire Adamson, I am 100% behind that idea, and everything that we do here is important that we remember that. And as we've heard and discussed at some length, the importance of good records management practice are keystone in delivering is paramount to this government. Such practice is auditable and a regulated requirement of government and governance. It allows our data and information to be in order to ensure that we can provide robust evidence of decisions taken. And the Scottish Government has high standards of records management, and we will continue to ensure that good practice and transparency is at the forefront of our records management. I'll take the members.
Jackie Bailey.
I am grateful to the Minister for giving way. Can I ask if ministers or special advisers or officials failed to submit any or all communications to that record management system, what sanction would they face?
As I've answered in numerous times when I've been asked this question with regards to the record management system, all decisions and all practices are actually done through the Scots IT system. There is no decisions taken any other way. So in order for us to make a decision and take something forward, it would have to go through that process. Your argument is actually not relevant in the scenario. Presiding officer, I would like to highlight some of the important work in relation to transparency that the Scottish Government has delivered as together. This will show how this Government is committed to and is delivering on being open and transparent. The Scottish Government's digital strategy is committed to increasing access to data and to delivering an ethical digital nation. And as part of this commitment, has been considering how data ethics play a role in government's use of data. This work has been involved in discussions with the public as well as academics to understand how the Scottish Government can increase transparency in the use of our data. Presiding officer, the Scottish Government is further committed to open government principles of transparency, accountability and public participation. As a clear commitment to transparency, we are currently delivering Scotland's third Open Government National Action Plan in partnership with civil society. Our action plans work to ensure that the trust, integrity and person-centred approaches are central to the function of this government. I'll take Mr Ross's point.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way when he is speaking about openness and transparency. I asked the Deputy First Minister if the investigation, which the First Minister launched 4 weeks ago, by the Solicitor General and by the Permanent Secretary had been delivered. She didn't cover that point in her remarks. Can you say if those reports have been delivered to the Scottish Government and what they said?
Minister. Currently, it's ongoing, Mr Ross, and if I can continue on open and transparency of government, our current commitments are areas in which civil society and members of the public have told us the ongoing promotion of transparency, participation, inclusivity and accountability is extremely important to them. An example of the work we have been delivering in collaboration with civil society, I will draw your attention to fiscal transparency commitment. Among other things, it's currently in the process of developing a fiscal transparency portal to make the Scottish budget information more accessible to the public. The platform will support understanding around how public money is raised and used by bringing together and presenting our fiscal information in a more accessible, open and understandable way. Presiding officer, at a time when misinformation
is on the rise. I want to emphasise that the Scottish Government recognises the importance of political integrity and transparency and takes issues extremely seriously. Our recent FOI performance has reflected this commitment. Information about the work of government can be obtained by members of this Parliament through responses to parliamentary questions and by all citizens through exercise of their rights under FOI law. Business across the Scottish Government have worked hard to complete our recovery from the delivery challenges for the pandemic and return to target performance levels for FOI. By increasing our data tracking, we have been able to identify earlier where delays might arise and as a result have averaged an FOI response rate of 97% since June. Given that our request numbers have increased 60% since the pandemic, our FOI performance is now better than at any point since the intervention began. And we will continue to work to do, including improving our training and further development, our network of case handlers and planning that is underway. And I'm very pleased to see that this achievement recognised in the progress report from the former Scottish Information Commissioner last month, and also to receive encouraging feedback with my first meeting with the new Commissioner, David Hamilton, when I met him last week. Finally, Presiding Officer, I would like to finish by reassuring the Chairman, Chairbar, of our commitment to do all we can to ensure that the important work of both inquiries can proceed at pace and that we have a robust process in place to do so.
Thank you. And I call on Murdo Fraser to wind up the debate. Up to 9 minutes, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will do my best to sum up the key points in this debate. As I should say at the outset, I share the disappointment of Douglas Ross and others that the First Minister himself has not been here to listen to this debate, which is fundamental to his leadership of the Scottish Government and indeed issues of integrity and transparency that Mr Adam just referred to. But let's just remind ourselves why this debate is so important. Over the last couple of weeks, I've listened to some of the testimonies given to the Scottish COVID inquiry by those who lost loved ones due to COVID and lost loved ones who died in care homes during lockdown restrictions. Some of these stories were truly heartrending. And they struck a chord with me because my mother died in a care home in February 2021 during the second COVID lockdown. And from the point we had to take her into a care home in December 2020, when we realised as a family we could not provide the 24-hour care that she required, we did not see her, we could not speak to her. The only point we could get in to see her was after she had the stroke that would kill her and she was lying unconscious. And like many other families, we had no contact with my mother over the last few months of her life. And many others faced similar situations. We've heard from Mr Adam just now, we heard from Ros McCall, we heard from others about the situations that others experienced. It is my view, and it's just my view, but it is my view, that the cruelty of that situation in not allowing people to see their loved ones in the last few weeks, months, or even years of their lives was a greater cruelty than exposing them to the risk that they might catch COVID and end those lives sooner. I know if I'd been able to ask my mother, she would have shared that view that I hold. And I know there are many other relatives, because I've heard their testimonies, who equally would share that particular view. I also know others will take a different view. And I would agree with the point that John Mason made in the debate. We were in unknown territory. We didn't know what we were up against. We didn't know what the risks were. And I don't blame anyone for the decisions that they were taking, because we didn't know what those risks were. But I do hope what these inquiries can actually be about is actually getting answers and learning lessons, getting answers as to why these decisions were taken. My mother wasn't given a choice. Other relatives were not given a choice. These decisions were taken for her and for us by the governments of the day. And what I want to I'll give way to Mr. Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
First of all, I'm very grateful to the member for going. Can I pay tribute to him for his candour and obviously very difficult personal circumstances? But does he agree with me that it's really important to understand on what basis those decisions were made, what information was being shared, both formally and informally, which is why so many having these WhatsApp messages is so critical, so we can understand what people knew and also what they didn't know that they should have done?
Murdo Fraser.
Yeah, I'm grateful to Mr. Johnson for that point. That's precisely the point I was about to make as to why these inquiries and why the issue of transparency is so important, because we need to learn the lesson. So if, perish the thought, we come up against this situation again in the future, we've actually learned from this experience and we know why these decisions were taken, and we know, should we have to take these decisions again, how we weigh that these harms to people, the harms in education, the harms in health we've heard about from others, as against the risks from COVID or another pandemic. So transparency is all important, Presiding Officer. So let's just remind ourselves of the timeline set out by Douglas Ross at the very start of this debate. It was back in June 2021. The UK Government wrote to the Scottish Government requesting that all material was protected, given that a UK COVID inquiry was going to be set up. In August 2021, Nicola Sturgeon, the then First Minister, announced a separate Scottish inquiry would be established and said nothing would be off limits. In December 2021, the then Deputy First Minister, John Swinney, announced the formal establishment of the Scottish Inquiry and pledged Scottish Government support. And in February 2023, the UK COVID Inquiry formally requested all messages, including WhatsApps, from the Scottish Government. And the wording of that request is fundamentally important to the point we're making today. And I'm just going to quote it. And this quote comes from a parliamentary written answer from Shona Robson on the 8th of November. The COVID Inquiry said this: please provide any communications relating to key decisions, including internal and external emails, text messages or WhatsApp messages on Scottish Government and private or personal devices held by the Scottish Government. Any communications, Presiding Officer. And I think that is unequivocal in its wording, despite what we've heard from the Scottish Government. And we know this was followed up with further requests in July, August and September 2023, amongst others. Then on the 31st of October 2023, Shona Robertson told the Scottish Government this: the UK inquiry asked in June for summaries of all WhatsApp and similar groups relating to coordination, logistics and day-to-day communication, thereby greatly expanding the scope of what the Scottish Government needed accordingly to collate and process. That request was followed in September by a request for the actual messages that were exchanged within those groups. And then Humza Yousaf, on the 2nd of November, told this Parliament, it is crucial to say when the UK Government inquiry asked us in June for details of the various WhatsApp groups concerning COVID-19, it did not request the messages themselves. The messages were asked for in September, just a matter of weeks ago. That's what the official report says. Now, I cannot see how that is reconciled with the wording of the request in February 2023 from the UK Government asking for any communications. If the Deputy First Minister can provide clarification as to why she thinks these two positions can be reconciled, I will give way to her, but I cannot myself see it. Yeah, I'll give way.
Deputy First Minister.
I was very clear in my speech today that the information set out in the statement, of course, related to the key decision-making interpretation of those original messages. If you look at my statement, I was very clear that there had been previous requests for information made by the UK inquiry. The acknowledgement the First Minister and I have made is that, looking back to the wording of that request, that it was too limited an interpretation. Would Murdo Fraser, though, accept now that all of that information that has been provided is now for the inquiry to decide, both inquiries to decide about the information provided to them, the scope of it and the adequacy of it?
Well, that's a very long intervention and a very unconvincing one, I have to say, to the Deputy First Minister. It doesn't answer the key point that I asked about the wording in February 2023 when they asked for any communications. But I would just say to the Deputy First Minister, you know, if she's so confident of her ground here, if she's so confident, why can't she support our motion? Our motion is not condemning the Scottish Government. Our motion is not saying that there's been a breach of the ministerial code. It's a straightforward motion saying this matter that is clearly in dispute should be referred to an independent adviser under the ministerial code. If the Scottish Government believe they're right, then the independent adviser, presumably, will vindicate their position. Why cannot they put it to an independent adviser to be assessed? And let's remember, this is something former First Ministers have done. Alex Salmond, if I remember rightly, referred himself twice to an independent adviser. Nicola Sturgeon did it herself in the context of the Salmond inquiry, as Douglas Ross reminded us. So what do they have to hide? Their refusal to do that suggests that they are on uncertain ground. Yes, I'll give way.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Meadow Fraser to give way. And on that point, would that not fulfil the Nolan principle of submitting themselves to the scrutiny necessary to ensure the transparency? Yeah.
Yes.
Meadow Fraser.
The convener of the Parliament Standards Committee makes a very fair point about the need for transparency. And I fear what we've heard from the government just typifies the sense of arrogance and entitlement from Scottish ministers that they do not feel they have to submit themselves to scrutiny from external bodies. And there's a clear parallel with what we've seen over the last few days from the Health Secretary, who is still missing in action from this Parliament, and the question of his roaming charges, where if he's done nothing wrong, why is he not being transparent and open with the information, and he can prove he has done nothing wrong? And the fact he's refusing to do that leads to suspicion there is something amiss in his behaviour, presiding officer. Presiding officer, I'm conscious I'm already over my time. Let me just say in closing. For years, the Scottish Government has presented a holier-than-thou attitude, claiming some sort of moral superiority over people at Westminster. Now, however threadbare that claim was previously, before today, it's now being exposed as wholly false this afternoon. I don't doubt the government's going to win the vote in a few minutes' time, because it will whip its backbenchers into supporting it. But in so doing, it will lose the last shred of credibility it's held. George Adam has just told us this government values political integrity and transparency. The families of COVID victims, the families of those who died in care homes, and the people of Scotland expect better from this government. If it really does care about transparency, if it really does care about truth and integrity, it will vote with the motion in name of my friend Douglas Ross. Well done. Thank you.